So, how many of you used NGINX before? A third of NGINX? Okay, actually, how many of you have not used it? Everyone. So, my job is easier. So, this is about me. So, I work for Adiquity. Adiquity is a mobile apps platform. It's actually a product of Guruji.com, which was a search engine, not anymore. So what we do is we are a mobile ads aggregator. So we aggregate ads from a lot of ad networks and serve it to our publishers. So in a sense, we serve ads. So typically, we have large requests coming in terms of, unlike other websites where it's actually the requests are user driven, these may not be exactly user driven. It might be that ad slots are placed on the pages. So the more number of ad slots, the more number of requests. So it's a job is to handle a lot of requests. So that typically is my role at Adiquity. So we try to make sure that there is no downtime and there is no latency in the ad server. So this is a brief history about NGINX for those who don't know. So it was started sometime around in 2002. He's a Russian dev. So in 2001 we started writing mod Excel, which was a replacement for mod proxy in Apache. It wasn't serving his needs, so he started writing mod proxy. And then he found that by the way it's written, it's not built for scale. So he kind of wanted to write something from scratch. So that is when he started writing NGINX. So sometime around, late summer 2002, he started. And around 2004, he had the initial drafts on for the public. And by the time he had started running it on Rambler.py. Rambler is a Russian search engine, pretty famous in Russia. So he was employed to Rambler. So that's why Rambler chose to run it. So the main crux of NGINX is to address the CTLK problem. So CTLK problem is basically to handle 10,000 concurrent requests. So the job of handling 10,000. So when I say 10,000 concurrent requests, it's being handled by a single box, not having an array of boxes and you handling 10,000 concurrent requests. So it was actually built to handle. So it addresses CTLK problem, and that it does very efficiently. There are quite a few. So there are quite a few products available outside, open source, like Tornado, people have heard about it. And then there is Cherokee, which is also gaining a lot of momentum now. But NGINX by far seems to be, the most common among people to have, people have adopted it after Apache. It's actually said that 25% of the top 10,000 high traffic websites use NGINX. I'm not sure when that was collected. It should be more. Now, after 10 years, now NGINX is pointed to a company now. So they do paid support and they develop paid modules. So CTLK problem is, as I said, it's to serve concurrent 10K connections. So this, if you've used Apache, you know how tough it is. It hardly scales, a few hundreds. If you could scale it for a few hundreds, then you've done a really good job trying to make it work. So why? The reason being, it's I/O. So I/O is always a bottleneck. It might be a file I/O or it could be a network I/O. So Apache's model of using a thread per connection never scales for, let's say, very high traffic websites. So sites like FB and all I think Hulu, a lot of other sites, started using NGINX. This is the main reason is, Apache can't scale. So if you want to have it, you'll have to have an array of Apache servers, which again is like a lot. I mean, you have to use a lot of machines. Now, how this NGINX handles this, using the equal mechanism. So select and equal are ways to actually find which file descriptors are active. So select mechanism is slightly, it takes a lot of time to use it. I mean, Apache uses it and a lot of other stuff uses it. Equal was started, I think 2.4 kernel, I'm not sure, I think 2.6 does support equal. So what essentially it has is select takes a max file descriptor as one of the arguments, and it has to run through all the file descriptors and see what is active at any point of time. And this is a lot of tasks. So every time an event has occurred, it has to run through all of it to find which is what event and what has occurred. Whereas equal takes in just which are the file descriptors you want to consider and takes in that. Now the advantage is in select is you don't have to pass the file descriptors, in which case the memory requirement is slightly less. Kind of outweighs the performance gain equal gains. So that is how NGINX actually scales better in terms of being fast and able to handle concurrent 10,000 connections. So small trivia, we at the moment handle roughly around 5K plus around 6K requests per second in a single box. And recently we moved to two boxes just to have a prevent single point of failures. So the URL which I mentioned is a very good resource for people who are interested in systems. It's more like a Bible. You need to read it if you are interested in to find out what are all things you need to know to scale in a system level. So these things are at a high level why NGINX is preferred among people. So the main reason is the layer 7 load balancer. So actually when we started around 2008, we were looking for some load balancer then. We had options of LVS, it's called Linux Virtual Server. It did work out, but the main problem was it was layer 4. So we couldn't do that, so you cannot load balance at the URL level. Let's say you want slash users to go to a different box and all this stuff, you couldn't do it with LVS. Otherwise, LVS is also a very good solution for load balancing at a layer 4 level, which is like at the TCP level. And it has the reverse proxy. So basically you can comment, so mod underscore proxy of Apache is kind of inbuilt into NGINX. So since it was it started with how they wanted NGINX, it has it inbuilt. Other one is the embedded Perl interpreter. This is a very nifty feature if you want to do something, something which NGINX doesn't support, but that's usually it will support most of the things you want. But if you want to do something else, let's say pass a piece of text or something else, and you are familiar and you are comfortable with Perl, you can write pieces of Perl code directly into the NGINX conf and have it pass it through to your backends and however you want. So the use case is, as I said, let's say you want to do something that you don't want to pass it to the application server to do it. This, let's say it's a very trivial job, but it's being done every time. So you want to, and it is very necessary before being sent to the load balancer. Let's say, for example, there is a piece of text, but you want to pass the text and see based on that, and you want to do it. So that kind of things you can write. If you're familiar with Perl, you write a piece of Perl code, put it there. It does a just-in-time compilation and has it there. Or you can have regexes. Let's say complex regexes. All this stuff you could have.
So something like URL rewrite.
URL rewrite. That is just. URL rewrite is supported natively in NGINX, so it supports PCI. So Perl is like you can have proper Perl code. Let's say you want to have a particular module, you want to have the application itself. you have a backend of CGI, I mean, a Perl CGI application, but you want to have a piece of it inside your engineering. So one example is, let's say, smart detection of user agents. So in R, I mean, this is, I mean, it has actually a reason why I'm telling this is, we have this case where we wanted to find out the device of, I mean, from the user agent, we needed to find the device. So, and for some cases, let's say you want to find it, whether it's the Opera Mini or not, these kind of stuff. So these kind of stuff you can do directly with Perl. I mean, if it's pretty simple. You can read the header, do it, and based on that, you can set a variable, and if the variable is set, you can send it to a particular host or do particular thing. So this is a very nifty feature. And the other one is on-the-fly binary upgrade. This we often use when we have, when we do change, when we push to the next version, we up it, we do this. So the good thing is you don't have, you have zero downtime. So what typically happens is you have an Nginx binary running and you send a USR2 signal. So when you send a USR2 signal to the master process, what it does is it creates a copy of the binary with the PID. It says PID dot the binary, and then it will start executing the new binary which you have given to it. Now at this point of time, both binaries will start accepting connections. I mean, even the old binary and the new binary will start accepting connections. Then you send a win signal. When you send a win signal to the old binary, root master process, it will gracefully shut down all the worker process. So when I say gracefully shut down, it's basically whatever request which it's got until then are serviced. It stops accepting new connections and it shutdowns all worker processes. And since it shut down all your, new process is live and it goes with that. I mean, you almost have zero downtime. In other case, I'm not sure in Apache if there is anything like that. I think you can do it with some kind of shell scripting and stuff. But this is, I mean, something which is built into Nginx. The other one is config changes. So let's say you want to change config. I mean, in Apache, I think you have to restart it. If you do change in http.conf, you have to reset it. Whereas, I mean, I think the, what is it called? The ones which are in the document, I think it's dot rewrite or dot http or something like that. Dot htaccess. That, if you change it, I think you don't have to do anything. But the main http.conf, which is in the etc or one, if you change it, you'll have to restart it. In which case, it has downtime. Even if you do a start and stop, you still have a minimal downtime. That is avoided here a lot, especially when you are handling a lot of users and you want very good experience for users. This this one which we were telling is the PCRE support for rewriting URLs. So this PCRE module is inbuilt into the Nginx. So any kind of regex match you want to do it on the URL and rewrite it internal. You want to do internal rewrites, you can do it with this. And of course, to sum it up, it's super fast, lightweight, and the low memory footprint comes because of the EPOL mechanism. It doesn't follow the single connection per thread, for every third connection kind of model. And it's like feature rich. Now, there is a saying which says, I think Apache does six things, but everything bad. But Nginx does all these five things out of it, but does it way faster than that. Something like that. So, yeah, but it actually does it. So, this is on the overview of the config. So, the config is actually it's a hierarchy model. So, it has a HTTP scope, then it has a server scope, then it has a location scope, and an upstream scope. So, these are all the contexts actually. So, HTTP scope is where directives where you will to have things like number of worker processes you want to have or number of connections you want to have. So this is for the whole Nginx server which you're running, the installation you're running. The server is used, server context is used for virtual servers. Let's say you want to have to run a server on port 80 and you want to have a HTTPS supported port, another one, or you want to have a 8081 also for testing purpose. So you can have everything inside the same conf and have according to it whatever configs you. So everything which goes into the server block. So since it's a hierarchy module, so it's like HTTP will have multiple servers, server will have multiple locations, and location will have multiple upstreams. So it will all, the hierarchy followed by any directives which are applied and the HTTP will be inherited by the blocks inside. So yeah, so server block also can be used for handling things like let's say it's a web host. You want to have you want to give a single, you want to have let's say one server, but you want to share it with multiple people and with subdomains inside. So then what you do is you just have multiple server blocks, and based on which domain is accessed, the server, and there's a directory called server underscore name. So based on which domain it's accessed, it'll go into that server block, and things inside that is configured or used, executed accordingly. So location block is like, which defines what the URI should do. I mean, let's say it says slash users. Now, when it has slash users, what should it do? To which backend, or you want to set some features and all that stuff, you could do that. So this is like the route in Node.js people have used. So it's typically like that. Just that the application code doesn't come here. It just says what each one of has to do. So if you want to do a REST API thing and all, you can set it up here and accordingly have different backends. It's very easy to do. The upstream block is the block which says which are the proxy servers. So it says, let's say A, B, C, D are the proxy servers, and you put it in this one, and it will, so when you get a request, so in the location block, you'd say if it's a slash content, go to this upstream block, and the upstream block is a named upstream block, and inside that you'll have four servers, so it'll go to one of these four servers. And you can define how to, I mean, what mode to use to go to the servers. That I'll cover up in the next slide. So these are a few directives which are very important when you configure Nginx. So worker processes, so Nginx model is you have multiple processes. One is a master process, which kind of receives all user signals if you want to pass it, and then you have worker processes. So anything which is passed to the master is passed to the worker automatically. The worker process has to run as a root if you're running it on a standard port less than 1024. If it's a non-standard port, you can still run it as a non-standard port. So worker processes, the you set the number of worker processes here. So you say worker underscore processes, let's say 96. So 96 processes will be spawned when you start Nginx. Worker connections, on the other hand, tells you how many connections you want to handle per process. Now these two settings actually are very important for you to know how many concurrent connections you can handle. So the number of concurrent connections which can handle is it's a product of number of worker processes into the number of connections. So if you know, if you can expect this is the kind of traffic I'm going to have this time, so you can set it accordingly. I mean, on the other hand, you can also set it to a very large thing, but the memory, I mean, since it's a number of processes, it's going to consume a lot more memory. So every single process is going to consume some memory. So if when on a requirement basis, you can change the config accordingly. Worker R limit no file is to set the number of file descriptors for the open sockets. Consider. If, in Apache and all, for that, you'll have to do it at the OS level. I mean, you'll have to write it in, I think, slash proc or somewhere. To set the number of open descriptors. Yes, you could do it in the Nginx config itself and do it. So worker R limit will be roughly be the same as the product of worker process and worker connections. So this is the number of open file descriptors at any point of time. So keep alive, keep alive is a direct HTTP directive. I mean, it's a header which is supported since I think HTTP 1.1. So it basically says, don't close the connection in the client side. So because of this, the client, when I say client, it's a browser. Typically, it's a browser. So the browser actually holds the connection so that it can use it for another request within the let's say same page or anything. I think there is a browser constraint as to a domain. You can have only two active requests, two active connections, something like that. So keep alive requests on the server side, it says, number of active connections it can have and the timeout it can set. So when you say 30 seconds, so these 100 connections will be held only for 30 seconds. The moment it passes 30 seconds, it will start closing the connections. This is very important because let's say you want to, so in the case of ads, which we do, you want to actually show the ads as fast as possible. You don't want the user to wait. So in this case, since the connections are already kept, open, it doesn't have to do a connect again. So this kind of saves a lot of time for the user to do. So it's only the read and write which will happen. It doesn't have to do. So in Firebug, if you do it will show you the connect time and then the read and then the write, response time, how much time it took to wait. So the connect time will not be there if you do, if you set the keep alives.
Does it make sense if I say that are there any ways to auto scale this worker process?
Auto scale worker process, I think there is no direct way to do it. There are other ways to do it actually. So it might not be that, so it depends. So you need to find out where your bottleneck is. So typically it will become that Nginx might not be the bottleneck at all. It might be that your backends are bottleneck. So you have an array of application servers that might be blocking a lot of requests. Nginx might be pretty cool. They'll be handling it very fast. So auto scale as such, it's not there. But what, which I'll cover in the next couple of slides, is there are ways to find out how much time it takes to respond to a request. So you could, of course, write a kind of shell script or something like that to find if there is anything like that. It takes, if the latency is high, you can do an automatic config change and do a reload. So it's, all these can be scripted, scriptable. So that way.
One second.
Would yeah. It be as simple as just changing these two parameters and running without struggling? Yeah, it's the same. It's so, since the configs can be. It doesn't require a restart at all. You go change the conf and do a kill hop. Hop is a hang up signal. You pass it to the master process, it will read the new config. If the config, let's say you have a syntax error or the config is wrong, it will not load the config at all, it will use the old config. So it's like, you can do whatever you want, kind of auto scaling you want. In fact, I think, probably think this same kind of mechanisms which Amazon's auto scale will use. Typical kind of things where it automatically changes one and have more units connected to it.
If you need it, is this needed? Is auto scaling really needed? Is it practical?
Well, it depends on the problem which you are addressing. The kind of request, if you are on the cloud and if you have, ability to add servers automatically, or if you have, a lot of resources in the system which could be used, you could definitely use it. This usually the kind of changes when you have a lot of static content to be changed. So only then this will be used. Otherwise, I haven't seen, auto scaling we haven't done. We kind of do it, we check it once in a few days, see if there is a problem. Typically it doesn't happen that way. It kind of scales at one point, you see that there are a lot of things, then you go and check where the problem is and you find it and you kind of change it. If it is 96, you make it 128 so that for it is kind of scaled for the next few billion requests, that kind of thing. Personally, I haven't done auto scaling with the script. But though we do something else where we kind of change the weightages to each of our backends automatically. So based on, it's a very a dumb way to do it, but that was the thing which we could do it with a short amount of time. What we did was we kind of go check the resources on each of these backends, collect data. Based on how what is the load on these kind of servers, we kind of change the weightages here so that the other one gets it. It's a poor man's fair balancer kind of. So this is the upstream block which I was talking about. So this is how you configure upstream block. You say upstream, the backend there. Last question. Okay. Upstream. It's the name of the upstream, and then you say server, and you give the IPs or domains of whichever host you want to have. So here in the example, I've given four hosts. So if you see, so you can have hosts running on whatever port you want. So when you say wait equal 3, so let's say you have five requests or six requests. The first request will be sent to the first server, second, the next three requests will be sent to the 13, the third server. So it's a weighted RR or weighted round robin kind of thing. And the last one says max fail 3 and fail timeout 10 seconds. So this config, it supports this kind of config also where you can say the maximum number of failures a particular backend can take. So when I say failure, it is actually defined by a property called proxy next upstream, which says what a failure is. A failure could be an error, or failure could be a timeout, or it could be a particular error code, HTTP error code from your backend. It could be something like a 502, a gateway timed out. Or, so, or generally, let's say a 500, let's say they have changed something and you're getting an internal server error. Any of these could be configured there, and that would be taken as a failure. And here, what it means is, it says it can take maximum of 3 failures within 10 seconds. So within 10 seconds, you had 3 failures for this server. Then what will happen is, this server will be made inoperative. So it will not send any more requests to it. So automatically it starts using only the top 3 where there are no. You can set the same event to all of the servers too. So here there is also this config called keep alive and a number. So here what it says is the number of live connections you want to maintain with your backend. This also helps, wherein you don't have to make a connection to your backend. So this was supported only recently, I mean, I think 1.1.4, which is like a year ago. Now it's like 1.2 or something, the version. This was supported very recently, and this we've been using it, and we found that this has a lot of benefit in our kind of setup. Pardon? Yeah. It'll actually reinitialize the counter. So it'll reinitialize the counter. So 10 seconds is the timeout. So you get three, let's say you have a burst of 3 requests and all 3 fails. It'll make it inoperative. So it'll wait for the 10 seconds to elapse. After that, it'll actually reinitialize the counter. So and then it maintains. So for within 10 seconds, you shouldn't have 3 failures. What? Which one? So keep alive is just like the keep alive which I mentioned sometime back. This keep alive is for maintaining the keep alive request with the clients, which is typically the browsers, the users. This keep alive is to maintain it with the backend. So Nginx keeps a keep alive with your backend server. So your backend could be something like an Apache server, or it could be a Rails server, or a Python, or anything it could be. So it keeps a live connection. So which means that it doesn't, when you get a request and you want to send it to a backend server, it doesn't have to do a connect again. So there is already a connection alive, it'll send it through that. So it saves a little bit of time. So here it says maintain 2048 live connections with the backend servers.
Something like a connection
pool. Yeah, so this is more the connection pool. Do the pooling of the connections. It's like reuse the same connections for the next request. So, and yeah, so you set up the upstream block here like that, and then you say in the server block, you say location when you have a slash, let's say www.abc.com. So, slash, so I'll, so here this location block actually tells which, this is like the which. URI which you have got. So it will match this, and it will say, it says proxy pass this request to the backend. Backend is the name of the proxy upstream which you have set, and it goes in here, and then it uses one of the models whichever you set. So which is here it's a weighted round robin, where this one will get slightly 3 times more than the other ones.
So you're saying that index will like get passed to the server
screen, yeah.
Yeah,
so here in this case, since I haven't put any max fails, even if it fails, it will keep still send the SIG request. So that that's why you have to put max underscore fails. If you put that, it knows that there is a failure there, so it will stop, it will make it inoperative.
So after 3 max fails, it will shift to the other.
Yeah, it will make it inoperative. Basically, it's like commenting out this. So it's like commenting out.
Bring it back
when the time is elapsed. So the 10 seconds is elapsed, it will make it actually reinitialize the variables again, and it will start sending it. Again, if you get it 3 recommend values, it will again make it. So there is also another directive which I will put it in the slide, where you can hard code a particular server as down. So when you say server a.b.c, something like that, say it down, which means that that server is down. So it will never send it across. It's like commenting out, but you set it down. So this is used when you want to do some kind of automatic configuration changes. So let's say you know that, I mean, you have some kind of heartbeat mechanism separately, and you kind of ping each of the upstream servers, and you get responses, and based on that, you know that something is down. Go ahead, change the config automatically saying this is down. There's also another one which says two servers, I mean, you can give it and say backup. So the backup servers are used only when these are not active, all of these active. Otherwise, it is always kept. So in the other case, what happens if you put all the servers here, all of them will be used no matter what. So it, this is kind of bad when you want to do EC2 and all. So it will be built for the iOS by sending to it, even though it, the other three servers can just handle it, I mean, easily. So you kind of say the servers here, and then you say it as backup. It will never be used until all three are failed. Yeah, and as I said, so this is the name of the backend, which is where to pass your connection to, which is this. You can name it whatever you want.
So essentially, all requests, all the requests I was having to do in this, get the data from the server, backend server.
Responses.
Deliver it to the
client.
Are there any API things to say?
So that it can be, so you have this include mechanisms where you don't have to have the whole config in a single file. So inside this, on this you can put an include a.conf. Inside that you can have only the server file, the name, I mean the IPs.
Right, but what if I want to automate shutting down a particular server?
So there is no direct way of doing it, but it's the config supports variables, directives to do that, which one of them is like down. Then other one is, let's say you do max fails itself of one and fail timeout of, let's say, one request per second. What happens, let's say you start a server or you don't have the server, you've shut down the server. So it will, since it's match fail is one, it will stop sending any request to it. You don't have a problem at all. So it only the other ones will be used. At the moment you switch it on, it will send them one more, and it will know that it's active and start sending.
Okay, explain what wait.
So wait is the typical way to do is the round robin, which is try this one, the next request comes and it goes in here. If you don't have the wait, it goes in like this. So the fifth request will again go to this one. Oh, the weighted round robin is you're giving weightage to it. So let's say a particular, you have a heterogeneous set of machines. One server, let's say, has multiple cores, and you know that this can handle a lot of requests. So then what you do is you set the weightage 3. So which means that for every, let's say, first request comes, second request comes, then the next 3 requests will be sent to this weight, sent to this server, because it can handle more connections. So as earlier I said, you can change anything you want at runtime in the config and send a hub signal. Hub is a hang-up signal to the master process and reload the conf. So there is no...
You have to send a hub signal to the master process.
Yeah.
And how do you identify that the process
right? It's a master. It will be running as root, or it will also say master.
There is a PID.
So PID file will be created whenever you start an Nginx. So that also you can, it's actually set in the config itself. What is the PID file name you want? So you can just say killhub cat that PID file in big backticks. That will also do it. New config, yeah. So you have log levels, you can set it info, debug and everything. If you go to the log, it will say that either if the config is wrong, it will say the config failed to reload and it's using the old conf. If it's reloaded to the conf, it will say that I've received a hub signal and I've reloaded the new conf. So this is a round robin versus a fair balancer. So not always does round robin actually work. So the problem being, it kind of sends a request to every other backend always. It keeps doing a round robin. But sometimes it might be that one of your backend servers, due to some request, let's say a DB bottleneck, it's doing a lot of connections and it keeps queuing up the connections to it. It will not wait. I mean, it will take the connection and it's going to do it. It's queuing it up. Now, this is bad because a set of users will see that it's always, I mean, it's taking a lot of time and Nginx is not helping much for it. So there is a third-party module available with Nginx. This is not yet available natively. If you compile the third-party module with Nginx, you have this thing called FAIR, where FAIR actually says, now if you put FAIR, the server knows the number of requests each of these has taken. So the next request is given to the least busy bucket. So if 1.2 has got, let's say, 5 requests and it's still processing them, and 1.3, let's say, has got only 2 requests, so it gives it to 1.3 instead of giving it to 1.2 again. In the round robin method, it'll be like every single time it'll be like doing a round robin with these. It kind of maintains a hash as the number of requests each one has got and how many, I mean, how, whether the connections have closed, number of the responses have got.
Before the file?
No, it doesn't show in a file. There is a way to find it out. I'll tell you. There's also another thing here which says no round robin. The no round robin is like, so in the normal way to do it is when you say fair, it kind of goes to the next least busy server. When you say no round robin, let's say the same server has finished processing the request, it'll take it up again. So we can kind of send it to the same server, and so you kind of know till what level your backend can scale. So you can know what are the total number of concurrent connections a particular backend can scale. So this is proxy next upstream, which is talking in the failure underscore timeout max fails. So when you say max fails here, the failure is defined by this directive. So the failure basically says here error. So error here means could be anything error. I mean, it could be something like a 500 error or 502, 504, whatever you have. It could also be just a timeout altogether. So it can take things like error or just say timeout or invalid header. Let's say the backend response of the invalid HTTP header, then also you can say that's a failure. Or you can set it to a particular error code, HTTP underscore 504. So only for 504, it is considered as failure. No, it doesn't include, I just said it. Just to emulate this, you put error. So it's like, it supports all of this. I have 10 more minutes. Okay, I have a lot more slides, I'll just run it through. So add header is to add a header to the response. So when you want to send a response to the client, and this can be used for debugging purpose. Let's say you want to know which backend actually served this. So what you could do is you just say X, some X who's the who which backend it is, and set that IP and set. So based on that, you kind of get to know which backend actually served this response. And cache control can be done directly from Nginx. The proxy set header.
Sorry, I've seen cache control public.
I really don't know. So this is cache control. So you can have this, we have this CPV or something like that. I never use cache control because ours is like always dynamic. What we do use add header was for debugging purpose, to know which backend it uses. So basically it's nothing. It can take any header and any value. So this is the header name and this is the value. You can set it to any header. So I'll go with proxy set header. The proxy set header actually is used to send a request header to the proxy. This feature we use it a lot because let's say you want to enable a particular feature in one of the backend. This can be used for it. Let's say you are developing on an experimental feature in your backend and you want to do it only for the, you want some live traffic to see how it kind of behaves. So what, instead of going ahead and changing the config there and enabling in the backend, in your application server, you write a kind of code where if you read headers, headers are cheap to read because you're not reading the body of the request, and you say, if this header is set or if this header has this value, then I could execute this feature code. So you can set the headers in Nginx itself. So you have multiple backends you want to do this. At one point in your Nginx, you set this proxy set header. So in this example, I have this proxy set header X. You have a feature foo, and you set it to 1. This header can be read by your application servers, and if it is set to 1, you execute a piece of code. If not, you don't execute it. So you can change it, you can toggle the flag win nginx, and based on that, you can kind of see the behavior of your experimental feature on line graphic. This is another good thing. General case, I don't know, a lot of people might not use this. So thing is, if you want to drop beacons, the beacons are to know in the HTTP world, to know if there is an event happening to another third-party server. The easiest way is to send an image tag. So in the image tag, you say image SRC equal to something. Now, if that is being called, it means that a particular event is handled. Now, this SRC thing which you put it, the URL, it shouldn't be a big resource, and it should not be a 404. If it's a 404, it's a bad kind of design. So for that, what we do is we drop a one-by-one pixel. So this is supported by natively by Nginx. So it has a, from the memory, it kind of serves a transparent GIF. When you say, let's say you have a request like saying abc.com/beacon, and you put empty GIF, this pixel will be kind of served over.
But I mean, how does that get imported?
It doesn't get terminated. It serves a, this one. It's a response is sent. The only thing is, and the other way you would have done is, you would have had a file in the file system, and you would have read it, I mean, you would have, you should have configured it to a small size, you should read
it.
And
you should have passed on to the application server,
this is in the logs. You have it in the logs. So you have in the logs saying /beacon from so and so. So when you do crunching of your logs, you get to know what events and what actions have been called by which query. So this is one more feature. So which is used to to throttle the number of requests you get per zone. So this is, I mean, we use it a lot during our search times. We had a lot of bots crawling our search engine. That time, to mitigate the DOS attacks, what we do is, we said limit request zone, and you set binary remote address, and then you say zone name, this is 10M says so much memory, and you say the rate, it says 1 request per second. So it can take a maximum of 1 request per second. And here you set limit request, and you set the zone name. So you can configure multiple zones according to whichever blocks you want, and say what is the zone name, and accordingly throttle the request. So anything above, let's say you get 2 requests per second, it will do a delay. It will not do it. The burst is actually, let's say you get 4 requests at any point, you set a burst level, then let's say you get 4 requests per second. For all these 4 requests, it will delay. Anything above 4, it will send a unavailable error code. This is another config which actually tells you what is the concurrency limit you want. So the other one tells just the request, but here it says concurrency. So at any point of time, let's say a particular domain can handle, let's say it can have only make one connection at a time. So some kind of bots, what it will do is, it'll just spawn threads from somewhere and it'll try to bring down a server. That you can actually kind of, you can actually use this for mitigating DDoS also. You say the binary remote address, whatever it is, and then you say limit connection 1, which means that it will allow per host only one connection at any point of time. Only after the connection is closed, it will allow another connection. Yeah, so the IP block, that is a separate thing. I mean, it's nothing to do with it. You are talking about IP block thing. So there you can set, there is something called deny and allow. So in deny, you can set up, let's say you know that from history that these IPs are some kind of bots and it keeps accessing your site. You can put it in a list and you can keep updating it. There's a deny and these set up. You could do that. You can put this in a particular block and say a deny block there. Then this is one, sometime back someone is asking this, stub status. So stub status actually tells at any point of time what is the status of Nginx. So say you've done location Nginx stack, stub status on, and if you access Nginx underscore stat on your, so here you can actually put, allow a particular IP alone. Let's say your local, your office IP or something like that, in your production IP. So that only from that IP you can access this location. So when you access this location, it will tell you number of active connections, number of total connections handled after it started. In this case, it's around 16 million actually. And the total number of requests. So at any point of time, it will also say what is right now number of in the read state, in the write state, and in the waiting state. So you keep refreshing it, you get to know what it is. That's so you can actually kind of have a script which can take data in peak times or every 5 minutes, and you can have a graph plotted to find out what is happening. There's another one is the map directive. The map directive is just like it's like the hash map concept, where you say map, these are inbuilt variables, and you say new. So new is another variable. So here you say basically URI, if it is slash AA, then I want new to be set to AA.domain.to, and BB, if it is slash BB, and so on and so. But the default, it's like a switch case. You do all of this, and you say default, if none of this is there, default is this. Now in the server block, you can say rewrite dollar new, this is a caret symbol, and it says dollar new, if it's slash, if let's say you have domain.com slash AA, someone is caught, then redirect it dot to, we say redirect. So when it will get redirected to the this one. Actually, there should be a space here. So this is very helpful if you want to have, let's say, domain parking and all that stuff. This is another very recently used release feature called split clients. This is used for A/B designs. Let's say you want to test different colors or designs to a particular set of users. You say a split client, and you can use, let's say, a remote address or any kind of variable that can be hashed, let's say cookie or remote. You can, so these are all inbuilt variables. So remote address will be replaced by the IP here. And you can say point first, 0.5% of the requests recorded dot, I mean it will be set as dot 1, and 2% is dot 2. And here you will say index dollar variant, which means that 0.5% it will be replaced with index.1.html. So that 1.html might have a different kind of, let's say, HTML, and the other one, 2% of it will be the other one, another HTML. So that HTML will have a different CSS or anything, and you want to know what kind of perception people have. Then subfilter is another filter. I mean, it's a directive to, let's say, you want to change something in the response. You've got a response and you want, let's say, copyright is there. And you know that this is a usual thing where people don't update the date. So you want to change it. I mean, before going ahead and changing every different file, what you can do is you can write a regex saying subfilter at copyright. If it is 2011, make it always 2012 or anything like that. All responses, anything which go, will be scanned through this, and it will be changed in same place. Error pages, just like Apache, custom error pages can be handled. You can set whatever you want. Let's say you want to make it Twitter or anything like that. Then there are this, I'm not covering these. These are very important directives, if, set, and rewrite. If it supports an if condition, so any variable you can check for its value with an if, though it doesn't support else, it supports only if. And you can do a set. Set is like assigning a key value pair, value to a variable. And rewrite is for internal rewrite, and you want to do a redirect based on a regex. And there are built-in variables, $r underscore parameter. Let's say you have slash users and id equal to 243. And now, if you want to read this parameter and accordingly send it to a backend or do something, what you do is $r underscore id. You see that any get parameter can be read through this in the Nginx config. Then accordingly do any kind of same way HTTP. Any HTTP headers, it can be read through. All underscores will be replaced by hyphens. I mean, all hyphens will be replaced by underscores. So you can. And these are the variables which I was talking about. So this and this are very important to know what is happening. So you can use dollar request time, which actually tells you end-to-end time of how much is taken by Nginx. And you can log it in your logs and later see what is the amount of time it's taking. Then upstream response time is to find out what upstream you are taking. And with your upstream server address also logged, you can kind of get statistics as to which upstream server is taking a lot of time. There are other lot of modules, XSLP and FLP, these are all inbuilt modules. So some problems are this, you don't have like Apache where you can load a module dynamically. And the documentation is bad. I mean now it's good. Since it started with the Russian thing, it is always a bit of bad documentation. There's a very good community, IRC. There are people who are answer all your questions. Sometimes we don't even do a Google, we go ask IRC, they kind of answer. So to the point, it's like pretty good.